So, we see see that scavenging is important. In fact, scavenging played a critical role in the origin of humans. We could say that we wouldn't be the what we are without carrion. Around 2 million years ago, there was an increase in the seasonality in precipitation in Africa. This led to a seasonal bottleneck in fruits and other soft plant foods. So Australopithecines were forced to diversify their diet. While Paranthropus lineage was evolving to eat seeds, roots, and other plant material, the Homo lineage started to scavenge. They mainly scavenge by confrontational scavenging, which means that they were diverting away the predators that killed the carcass or defending the carcass against other predators which were coming. And this confrontational scavenging contributed probably greatly to the most distinctive features of humans, the collaborative cooperation and language development. It was also important for the development of endurance running, the improvement of tools, and the brain enlargement. So what happened today with the scavengers in the world? We did a review of the global patterns in scavenging of big game hunting subsidies. We gathered information from all the continents, and we found a general structure for the scavenging communities. Mainly, most of the scavengers are bird species, and most of them are generalists. We showed that anthropogenic food from hunting subsidizes many vertebrate species from different trophic levels and conservation status, and that's expected to affect from population to ecosystem. We showed the unexpectedly important role of not only obligate scavengers, but also apex predators in structuring the scavenging communities worldwide. We also investigated the influence of carcass size in the structure and functioning of scavenging assemblages. We used the data from my South African state, and we saw that larger carcasses support higher species richness. The community of scavengers is more nested, and the consumption is more efficient than smaller carcasses. So there are very important differences between carcass size. We used three kinds of carcasses: domestic chickens, ungulates from 10 to 100 kilograms, and ungulates from above 100 kilograms. And we see how the scavenger composition is changing according to carcass size. As I said before, most of the biomass of every carcass is consumed mainly by facultative scavengers, not vultures. Vultures eat only a small proportion, so it's against our traditional thinking. So facultative scavenging is very important. This led us to suggest some differences between predation and scavenging assembly. For example, as the prey size increases, there's less probability of an animal to be killed by a predator. Big herbivores, they usually die causes of besides predation. On the contrary, the larger the carcass, the larger the consumer that's going to eat it. So maybe we suggest that competition from scavengers and the composers may be an additional cost for seeing big prey that it hasn't been taken into account until now. We have studied the influence of species richness and the structure of the community, the nestedness is a kind of a structure. The competitive dynamics of the system, of the scavenger system. We used seven scavenger communities in Spain, and we did a local terra model. We modeled the proportions of competitive exclusions. We mean competitive exclusions are when a carnivore stop consuming a carcass. It's not that it's going to extinct. It's just stopping consuming the carcass. So we see that as the nestedness of the community increases, the proportion of competitive exclusions is stabilizing, and the same with species richness. We are working now trying to disentangle the contribution of species richness and nestedness in this pattern, but it seems that in highly competitive scavenger assemblies, the structure they have favor the coexistence of more interacting species. And this could be due to some facilitative interaction driven mainly by vulture and other minor scavengers. We have reviewed the interspecific interactions that links predation and scavenging. The traditional view is that scavengers interact with carrion, that predators interact with light prey, but that they are like separate parts. But today we know that this is false. All the compartments are very interconnected. Just because carnivores also feed on carrion. So this arrow is very important. This is triggering some competitive and facilitative interactions between facultative and obligate scavengers. For example, vultures can compete with facultative scavengers because they usually find quickly the carcasses, and if they are many individuals, they can deplete quickly the carcass, and maybe when a lion is coming, there's nothing to eat. But lions can also prevent the consumption of carcass by vultures. Successfully with them, but also predators can find carcasses by watching the vulture behavior. They can see like this, and, oh, there's a carcass, and the same in the opposite way. So vultures can wait until a predator is completely full, and then can access the carcass. And this competitive and facilitative interaction between facultative and obligate scavengers may have total consequences on herbivore and prey populations. So the classic view that scavenging doesn't affect the population dynamics of consumed organisms is questioned, as multiple indirect top-down effects emerge when considering carrion and its facultative consumption by predators as fundamental and dynamic components of food webs. And scavengers are very important for ecosystem services, which are benefits that humans obtain from nature. They have provided many and still providing many ecosystem services during the whole course of human evolution. As humans evolved from carcass consumers to carcass providers, the overall relationship between humans and scavengers was from competition, was shifting from from competition to facilitation. And these changing interactions have translated into shifting provisioning, regulating, and cultural ecosystem services provided by scavengers. For example, when we were scavengers, other scavengers could signal us where the carcass were. An example of regulating service is the removal of animal debris and the control of infectious diseases. And some examples of cultural ecosystem services may be the ones we saw before, the development of language and social cooperation, symbolic, many parts of the scavengers were used as symbolic ornaments in all cultures, and even in some cultures today. And recently, it's an important cultural service from scavengers, which is the ecotourism. However, vultures and large predators, which are the main scavengers, are disappearing. And this has important consequences. So supplanting the ecosystem services provided by scavengers has important economical and environmental costs. For example, this is a study done in Spain, which is home of 95% of European vultures. After the bovine sponge form encephalopathy in Europe in 2001, there was a very restrictive regulation that said that every livestock carcass had to be removed from the field and transported to some plants for processing and incineration. So this changed totally the natural scenario in which vultures and other scavengers quickly remove the carcasses in the field. So we tried to quantify this part of the new regulation scenario. We saw that annually, because of this transportation, the emissions of CO2 to the atmosphere is very high. It's about, for comparison, it's about 8% of the emissions associated to the chemical industry in Spain. So it's much. And near $50 million to insurance companies, because farmers must pay an insurance every year for covering the cost of the transporting process. So it's crazy. We saw also that there's a positive association between the CO2 emissions and the distribution and richness of obligate scavengers, which means that in the areas with more livestock, the areas which originate more emissions are the areas with more obligate scavengers, with more vultures. So maybe in those areas, the scavenging process, the natural scavenging process is very efficient, and we don't need the transport to do all these things. So maybe it's better to let nature do its job. Fortunately, this kind of arguments led to 2 years ago, more or less, to change the former regulation, and then the new regulation is a little bit less restrictive. Now it's allowed to leave the livestock carcasses in some places which are important for scavengers. So we are returning slowly, but we are returning to a natural scenario. So in the last 10 years, more or less, there has been a growth in the number of papers, scientific papers related to scavenging, carrion, vulture. So we can say that we are witnessing the golden age of scavenging research. The traditional food webs were very simple, like producers, herbivores, carnivores, and top predators. Then, a few decades ago, the incorporation of the detritivory was a big improvement of classical food webs. And modern food webs should incorporate also the scarring. However, we saw that universities in general failed to integrate scavenging into ecological teaching, as can be judged from the lack of importance of this process in the ecology textbook. We reviewed the 20 most common ecology textbooks in the world. Almost none of them mention any word about scavenging or carrion. So we advocate that the students should be aware of the important role that carrion and scavengers play in ecosystems. However, almost all this knowledge has been made by using by studying herbivore carcasses like chickens and galettes, big herbivores, elephants. But what happens with carnivore carcasses? And this is why I'm in Berkeley this month. I came to Wayne's lab to complete a study started in Spain. So Wayne and his student Oliver are a very important part of this work that I'm going to show you briefly now. We studied the consumption of herbivore carcasses from one species, the Barbary sheep, and carnivore carcasses of red fox. Barbary sheep is the most abundant ungulate in the study area, Sierra Espuña. Red fox is the most abundant carnivore in the area. So after recovering the camera traps, so on, we saw strong differences in the consumption patterns between herbivore and carnivore carcasses. Briefly, red fox carcasses were untouched. So while Barbary sheep carcasses were eaten almost completely in 1 week as average. So there are some species that go visiting the red fox carcass, but almost or none of them is consuming the carcass. This corresponds to three carcasses in which Eurasian jay were eating, but in the pictures it's not possible to see if they are scavenging or eating worms or something like that. So, but anyway, it's very, very small. The detection time of each kind of carcass was very similar, but then the consumption patterns were totally different. We could think that, okay, Barbary sheep carcasses and red fox carcasses are very different, so how control that? Well, we did an experiment with portions of meat, same size, different species. We placed 10 experimental units, each of it consisting of one piece of Barbary sheep and one piece of red fox, separated about 50 meters. After a week, we were visiting the places, and 60% of Barbary sheep portions were eaten, and all red fox carcasses were intact, were untouched. So there must be some risk associated to the consumption of carnivore carcasses. And the next step is to model this behavior. Oliver and Wayne have done a very nice model of the evolution of the carnivore scavenging behavior. When they have the opportunity to eat two kinds of carcasses, a herbivore carcass, no risk, and a cardboard cutout with some trees. Here is the screenshots for an example, a multi-run using 250 agents or individuals and 250 generations. I'm not very familiar with this kind of model, so I'll try to explain it properly. Otherwise, please, Wayne and Oliver, correct me. But basically, what we see is that the probability of consuming a carnivore cactus is rapidly declining, and at the end, the probability is very low. And sometimes we can see several phenotypes, several groups of individuals with similar fitness but different probabilities of eating a carnivore carcass. But anyway, the probability is very small. This is, in fact, this is 0.6%. 6%. Okay. So it's very low anyway. Most of the time, when there are several phenotypes, most of the individuals are in this group. These results are consistent through different parameter values. In fact, other parameter values normally lead to the extinction of the carnivore population. So, yeah, there must be some risk that carnivores per se. So this is not worth to eat this carcass. And why? The approximate cause, maybe smell is important. They can recognize the smell of a carnivore and herbivore carcass. We have shown that nor size, nor specific morphology, microhabitat features are important. But looking for the ultimate cause, we have three main hypotheses. Predation risk, many big carnivores kill smaller carnivores as a signal of status in an area to say to other carnivores, I'm here, so it's better for you not enter to my territory. But we observe in the carnivore carcasses, in the fox carcasses, that a single individual was visiting the carcass several consecutive days. So that's not very consistent with this hypothesis. Another hypothesis is that species in the higher trophic levels, they can accumulate contaminants. But the main contaminants in nature are relatively recent. They are on an evolutionary time, they are very recent, so maybe it's not very consistent. And the disease risk is maybe the most plausible hypothesis. Disease risk currently or at an evolutionary scale in the past. Some evidence is supporting this is, for example, that carnivores that kill all other carnivores almost never eat them. Cannibalism is very, very rare in nature. In fact, some humans and Neanderthal populations, maybe they went extinct because they were consuming other humans infected by a prion. And nowadays, we reviewed the parasites, the internal parasites of red fox, stone martens, and white boar, which were the main mammalian scavengers in our study area. There is no parasite with an indirect cycle with one carnivore and one carnivore. So all parasites are they have a direct cycle, or if it's indirect, they have to pass through a herbivore and then a carnivore. No carnivore. That's because in evolution is it was very difficult to. It's not an evolutionary. Evolutionary is not a success strategy. And this has important consequences. First, carnivore carcasses are an important food source for invertebrates and microorganisms, because they are available for a longer period of time. Herbivore carcasses are consumed very quickly. They are an indirect source of food for small vertebrates that feed on those invertebrates, for example. To have carnivore carcasses in the field is not important for is not leading to a high disease transmission risk, because no contact between the carcass and the consumer. So we have seen much scavenging. But carcasses have also non-trophic functions. We did a study during my stay in South Africa with this kind of bird, glossy starling. By chance, we saw this picture. This is a chicken, the rest of a chicken carcass. We saw the starling about the carcass and carrying a feather. Okay, this is curious. I'm going to investigate. I saw that this kind of bird usually adds feathers on the nest. So maybe it's a sexual selection thing. These feathers. So we saw that this is the total chicken carcasses and angelic carcasses we studied in the study area. This is the proportion about 20% of chicken and angelic carcasses were visited by starlings. Within the visited carcasses, about one death or two deaths of the times, starlings were observed with a feather in the beak. Most of the pictures of starlings were taken after vultures or any scavenger. This is an error. It's not only vulture. Any scavenger were eating at the carcass. Taking feather behavior was only observed after vulture or after scavenger were feeding at the carcass. So starlings need scavengers to obtain feathers at carcass sites. This is a novel type of commensalism. So non-trophic functions of carrion, I think they are a very fruitful avenue for future research. To finish, just to mention that many large scavengers of the world, many vulture species, many apex predators are endangered. Now more than ever is a good moment for doing research on carrion ecology. That's all. Thank you very much. Normally, we use experimental carcasses, so maybe field rangers had to kill an angelic because it was, entering a campsite or some problem, or they found a carcass in the road, a fresh carcass. They took the carcass and gave it to me. So I put it in most of times I could put the carcass in the places I wanted, so randomly. But in this case, for example, is a rhino or an elephant is too heavy, so to move So we try to find them as quick as possible and going rapidly with the camera. Only a few times we got the cactus quickly. Normally we got the cactus after one day, for example, and it's too late because many scavengers are there, so we couldn't use those data. But mostly, and in another, in a neighbor reserve, which is called Mkusi, there are no lions there. Managers try to provide supplementary feeding for vultures, because vultures apparently are dying a lot because they don't find enough food within the reserve and they go outside when they get poisoned or something like that. And they kill a carcass every week, an Niala impala, for example. And I could use those carcasses for my research as well. So most of carcasses, answering your question, are experimental carcasses.
Did you have any opportunities either in Spain or South Africa to look at the scavenging behavior of pigs or boar and whether they would eat carnivore carcasses?
Of
pigs or boar? Wild boar. Pigs.
Sorry.
You know,
yeah.
Like warthog and South Africa.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've faced a number of white boars in Spain.
And they eat carcasses?
Yeah.
I mean, they eat carnivore carcasses.
The white boars didn't eat the fox carcasses. But they eat the herbivore carcasses a lot.
That's not what I saw in the movie.
Apparently, pigs and boars love to eat humans.
Yeah, right.
I'm curious if you've looked at all that scavenging on gut piles or other remnants from human hunting activity or other human hunting.
I'm not sure if you probably understand this.
Well, that was the diversity and distributions review was about these subsidies from hunting. And that's mostly the intestines and gut, is that right?
Yeah. Very variable, but
right.
It's from whole animals to animals without head, without the skin, without the main meat, so just the intestines. Yeah, and we are now studying the differences between these different types of remains. Because it's very different. In some places in Spain, after a big game hunting day, they put all the remains in the same place, so it's a big mountain of remains. Yeah. So this is very different from a single carcass.
Yeah.
You know? So we are studying that as well.
Okay. How would the carrion ecology differ between a tropical environment such as Africa and a continental environment such as Yellowstone in the winter?
Mm-hmm.
The duration that the carcass is available is very different.
Yeah, but we can see general patterns in this variability. We are starting to explore these regional differences. We just did a first approach, very simple, and we are now going to incorporate more variables like herbivore density, human density, everything. So we are on the way.
Can I ask you something about it's a little bit different perspective, but you mentioned this with humans actually. But so in California right now we have the mountain lion or cougar or puma or whatever you want to call it is expanding, but also black bears in California are expanding. And there's a hypothesis that mountain lions are killing much more deer than they can consume. in places where the black bear has returned, and it's because the black bear is able to steal, and that this could have important consequences for population dynamics and predator-prey interactions. And the same hypothesis has been put forward for wild dogs in Africa having to kill at higher rates because where the risk of losing their kill to bigger scavengers. Have you seen, it seems like, I mean, so Wayne is nodding, he knows this is a simple model to look at what the population predator-prey consequences would be. But have you seen this formalized? Have you seen studies that really formalize this?
There are a couple of studies with cougar.
Yeah, okay.
And cougar, jaguar, I think, in South America. And some approach also in Poland with and North Europe with lynx and wolverine.
Okay, all
right. But they are very simple. They are not, they're just saying, yeah.
Just observing this, yeah.
This is except a cost for the predator because the scavenger is stealing that. But they are not looking for the consequences for herbivore.
Yeah,
population.
Yeah.
I think it's one of the main things we have to
like a really important role for scavenging and in this thinking about predator-prey dynamics. And particularly because these predators, you know, if they're really killing at much higher rates, more than they really need to because of the risk rather than
that is one of the most interesting things for me, but it's complex because you need good demographic data.
Right.
I think modeling could play a very important role in that. So there's an ample space for very interesting things.
Yeah. Any other questions before we wrap it up? Okay, well, thank you again.